Who were they?
The key military figures of World War II in the Pacific arena are...
General Douglas MacArthur.
The decorated soldier who went from Japan's sworn foe to leader. Famously declaring, "I shall return," MacArthur steered US forces across the Pacific until he accepted Japan's unconditional surrender.
The Daily Telegraph marks the 60th anniversary of victory in the Pacific. But if Douglas MacArthur could still return, he wouldn't recognise himself. Instead of using a photo of the General's famous mug, the telly have used one of Gregory Peck, who played him in the movie. The real General MacArthur looked like this. Hello and welcome to Media Watch. I'm Liz Jackson. The Adelaide Advertiser had a rather more serious photo problem in this promotion for their classified ads.
Weekend shopper.
You can sell goods for free.
Emily Ramsden was given plenty of new furniture when she married in January, and she needs to make room by selling her old furniture.
When Emily placed her ad, the advertiser asked if they could take her photo to promote their new free ads.
Emily Ramsden contemplates her savings.
Emily told us that photographer Ben McMahon wanted her to lie on the bed.
He asked me to lie on my stomach, which is quite hard to do when you're 6 months pregnant. Then he said, OK, move up to the bedpost. He kept trying to get me to move up more.
The photo that was published does make a big feature of the bedpost, attached to which are these. Emily was shocked and embarrassed.
The handcuffs were a gift from a friend, given as a joke. We've never used them. I didn't even think about it when the photographer was taking the photos. I've been crying about it for days. We've had people ringing up my husband saying, look at what she gets up to.
The Advertiser's editor, Melvin Mansell, told us their photographer
did not deliberately frame the handcuffs in the picture. He tried to disguise them after a conversation with Ms. Ramsden.
Oh, really? We asked Emily Ramsden about that conversation and she moved from embarrassed to furious.
That's a complete lie. I never discussed the handcuffs with him, either at the time the photo was taken or afterwards.
Editor Mansell does admit that the paper's editorial staff knew the photo showed the handcuffs, but went ahead and published.
I apologise to Ms. Ramsden and her family. The photographer has been suspended for 1 week while this is investigated.
But will the photographer wear this crass error of judgment alone? Whatever made the editors think that Emily might not mind the cheap laugh at her expense and the lewd phone calls? She told Media Watch,
I've had to get my home number changed because of this.
The Red Cross is also feeling aggrieved after a recent series of articles caning them from Sydney to Perth. It started like this in the Sydney Morning Herald.
Red Cross tsunami cocktails turn sour.
Gerard Ryle.
Until last night, a wine and canapes event at the Sydney headquarters of the Australian Red Cross was to have been funded from money given to homeless tsunami victims.
The story ran the day after the event, which Gerard Ryle said was
the first in a series of catered parties for wealthy donors.
The West Australian picked up the Herald story and ran it even bigger on their front page.
Charity pays for cocktail parties.
The Australian Red Cross will hold a series of lavish cocktail parties for wealthy donors around the country.
Their cartoonist weighed in as well.
It says, you are invited to a cocktail party to celebrate the wonderful work of the Red Cross. Dress, black tie.
The following day, Chris Joyce, who actually went to the Red Cross evening, contacted Media Watch.
I have no association with the Red Cross other than to have made a tsunami donation and to have attended the information evening.
He went on to tell us around 20 people were there.
The event was held in a meeting room at the Red Cross offices with cafeteria chairs to sit on. There were no cocktails. It was an aid worker giving a talk on her time in Banda Aceh and that was it. The invitation said there'd be light refreshment. Light refreshment was overstating it. The wine seemed to be Chateau cardboard. There was instant coffee, block cheese and Cabanossi sausage. it certainly wasn't a black tie or tiara affair.
So could this be the same event that the Herald described? Where was the catering, the party and the cocktails? Well, the Herald hadn't actually gone, as journalist Gerard Ryle confirmed.
No, I did not attend.
But what of Ryle's claims that the evening was to have been funded?
From money given to homeless tsunami victims.
The Red Cross says the event cost just $300. They concede their communications manager, Vedrandra Kulich, initially said it was an administrative cost of the tsunami appeal, but that Vedran asked Gerard Ryle for the questions in writing so that he could go and check. Ryle sent this email later that day.
How does the Red Cross justify spending money raised for tsunami victims to wine and dine an elite group of donors?
Vedrandra Kulich replied 6 hours later.
Sorry about the wait. I had to get to various people to provide me with relevant information. Red Cross is organising a series of information briefings for donors who made a significant contribution to the tsunami appeal. Any costs, including refreshment costs, will not come out of the tsunami appeal fund.
So did this outright denial cause Ryle to drop his story? No way. He claimed his questions had forced the Red Cross to change its plans.
Until last night, a wine and canapes event was to have been funded from money given to homeless tsunami victims. But the picture changed rapidly when questions were asked.
Now, the Herald and the West may believe their accounts are right, but the evidence they've produced for their damaging claims looks thin or wrong, a beat-up at best. But their stories had an immediate impact, as the letters page revealed.
Red Cross loses the plot.
People like me who donated to the Red Cross's tsunami appeal might think not twice but thrice about repeating the act unless we are assured no part of our hard-earned goes to entertain the generous folk of the Cabernet and Canapes circuit.
The West shed crocodile tears for the damage their stories had done.
Sadly, any backlash against the Red Cross may be to the detriment of people who most need its help.
Spare us, please. Now, while we're in WA, let's check on Perth Talkback host Howard Sattler. He's been a regular on Media Watch since he made his first appearance back in 1990 when Stuart Littlemore hosted the show.
Six Aboriginal children were joyriding in a stolen car which crashed when being chased by police. All were aged between 12 and 15. Three were killed.
Well, I say, good riddance to bad rubbish. That's three less car thieves. I think they're dead and I think that's good.
So 15 years later, let's hear what's changed. Does Howard still think it's good news if Aboriginal offenders die? Howard was co-hosting a regular talkback segment with Huey the cabbie when David phoned in.
I was just inquiring about these, your justice system, right? Mm. I reckon it's just too soft, mate, you know? Like, I'm in a wheelchair, and August last year, I got speared by an Aboriginal glue sniffer.
Goodness gracious.
Went to court on the 1st of July, he got 100 hours.
He didn't go to jail at all?
Didn't go to jail at all.
But David...
I wonder why people want to take the law in their own hands.
David, it's Huey, mate. I bet the Defence Counsel stood up giving all the mitigating circumstances in the world as why he did this crime.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah,
it's
not on.
It's just too soft, mate. Nigger, pull the trigger, as far as I'm concerned.
Right, David.
He said that.
I didn't say that.
And they didn't say,
I didn't say that.
He said that.
No, Howard, you didn't say it. But you seemed to think it was pretty funny, and you allowed it to go to air. All talk back at 6pr is on a 10-second delay so that calls like that can be cut off. The next day, Howard made his excuses.
On yesterday's program, I inadvertently allowed on air part of a listener's call, which, on reflection, could have offended members of the Aboriginal community. And that wasn't my intention, and the views expressed by the caller were not supported by me, my studio guest, or this radio station.
Inadvertent, could cause offence. Let's just have another listen.
Nigger, pull the trigger, as far as I'm concerned.
Right,
he said that.
I didn't say that.
Would you call that support or just indulgence? It's certainly not a rebuke.
And in retrospect, I probably shouldn't have allowed the call to continue. I shouldn't have allowed it.
Well, Howard, we agree with you there. But we know how hard it is to break old habits. Sevens Today Tonight is also behaving true to form. Anything goes, especially when it comes to bagging an opposing network's program like Ten's Australian Idol.
The first starry-eyed contestants on Australian Idol and other television singing competitions are understandably hoping for fame and fortune. But now some of the biggest names in the music industry are saying enough is enough and that Australian Idol is all about television, not music.
And which big names would they be? Today Tonight approached legendary singer Renee Geyer, but she didn't want to know.
They called my manager and I said no. I don't like the show and I don't want to be on it.
So who did TT get instead? Let's watch and see.
Apart from the Idol judges, no one's criticising the contestants. They're the victims. Barely out of school, history tells us they'll be one-hit wonders at best. Just this week, Renee Geyer, one of the best voices this country has produced, said at that age, it's simply asking too much.
I'm just starting to get good. I'm only just starting to realise what music is about.
What's going on here? Well, when Renee said no, Today Tonight simply pinched an answer she'd already given on the ABC's Enough Rope and dropped it in completely out of context. Her answer had nothing to do with Australian Idol.
Your last album, Tenderland, sold 40,000 copies, which is huge in this country. Your new one tonight's had great reviews. Do you think you're at your peak?
I'm just starting to get good. I'm only just starting to realise what music is about and creating things and getting ideas.
Renee was appalled.
They shouldn't be allowed to do that. Did they think no one would notice? All the stuff they talk about is old potatoes. It's just a big, fat beat-up.
We couldn't agree more. And while we're talking big, fat beat-ups, Today Tonight reporter Dave Sluggo Richardson last week won the Ernie Award for the most sexist media personality of the year. The judges were particularly appalled by this ambush in a shopping centre car park.
How many kids have you got?
Five.
How many dads have you got?
Oh, I don't do this, thank you. No.
How many, Doug?
No.
Sluggo wasn't there to collect the award himself, so we've been asked to hold it for him. So, Dave, feel free to come by any time. Maybe I'll see you in the car park. Until next week, good night. Wow.